In 2013, Chicago realized the promise of smart cities with CTOS, a citywide operating system merging big data with surveillance, security, and transit programs. With a few hundred lines of code, hackers were able to hijack its central servers and cripple the entire grid. Many believed the attack would be a killing blow for smart city development. They were wrong.
Welcome to San Francisco, running on CTOS 2.0, the world with a PR firm. The heart of darkness, bathed in sunlight. This is where Bloom has made its nest, and this is where Marcus Holloway will stop them. By now, Watch Dogs is a household name, a disappointment so widespread and infamous it could be the basis for the future's myths. This sequel had work to do, sell in a market where half the target audience would never spend money on this franchise again, and the other half would judge every detail with the harshest skepticism. In that light, it is no surprise Watch Dogs 2 seeks to differentiate itself so strongly. Color where there was once gray, life where there was once death, and this.
By the way, we put this playlist together to set the mood. Hope you like it.
If this has Imagine Dragons on it, I'll call the National Guard. Marcus is not Aiden. He's youthful, wild, and most notably, not a sociopath. He's also not a member of DedSec, which is why we're here. Initiation. This takes the biscuit for the most efficient introduction I've seen in AAA gaming yet. Tone, protagonist, parkour, combat, stealth, hacking, premise, supporting characters. Everything you could ever want to know is set up within these walls. 10 minutes on the clock. Things predictably go better than expected for Marcus. Yeah, every time a writer introduces a super hacker these days, they're always made out of hack the Pentagon age 3 with a Raspberry Pi and a jump lead. Marcus is like that, except instead of the Pentagon, he's strong, quick, a master of parkour, hand-to-hand combat, stealth, gunplay, and a genius on the computer all in one. How could DedSec refuse? Meet Wrench, he makes dumb jokes. Sitara, she makes worse jokes. And Josh. Josh has autism, a trait which is only used to make more dumb jokes. I think they really took this whole distance yourself from the first game thing seriously, huh? The sunny, colourful title drop, the walk of shame, the partying and pop culture references. Vibrance is the theme of San Francisco. Makes sense this would be the place to not be Chicago. Shit, but in a very literal sense. Oh, Cali. Thankfully, none of the methods used to bring San Fran to life involved human fertilizer. Graphics was one of them. Though no city, Ubisoft or not, has topped Unity's Paris in terms of raw graphical power, San Francisco is at times so full of character I'd take it in a heartbeat. Look at that sunset. The way the Golden Gate Bridge reaches out into the distance is considered one of the greatest sights the world has to offer, so this being a Ubisoft game, it lives up to the legend. It is a legend. I have 90 hours clocked on Steam, and San Francisco amazes me in the way it immerses me to this minute. The lighting, the detail, the size, the water, the people. It makes Los Santos look like child's play side by side. So, let me take you on a tour. Not to see the sights, but, win or lose, to see the remarkable ways this game tried to push the bleeding edge forward. First stop, Watch Dogs 2 is systemic. Straight from the horse's mouth, that means game systems were developed and designed with the intention that one could influence the other. If you're a regular here, you'll know I've been beating that exact horse since the dawn of time, but under a different name. Dynamic. Every game has systems, systemic isn't self-explanatory, but dynamic puts emphasis on what's important, the nature of one thing affecting another in a chain. Combat and driving are both viable examples, with AI that responds to your input, to their surroundings, and to each other. But these things have existed at a fundamental level for decades. When we say dynamic now, we mean something more, and we have two very good reasons to want it. For one, it's immersive, incredibly so, and that's because real life is dynamic. A living, breathing world will always live more and breathe more when things react according to their believable complexities, beyond voice lines and running away. The things I have seen these people do. At its simplest, cars in Watch Dogs 2 have owners, and if they witness the theft, they'll pull you out. If any two civilians start a fight, the police will arrive and arrest the suspects. If one of them resists or attempts to flee, the police will react accordingly. If a gang is nearby, things might get ugly. The Tezkas, the 580s, the Bratva, the Auntie Shoeboys, the Sons of Ragnarok. San Francisco Bay is divided up between all five of them, with their clashes proudly displayed in the top right corner. This is Ubisoft showing off. They want you to see this life, even in death, especially in apathy. You'll know what's happening as you drive through a neighborhood, whether you care or not. Perhaps you should. Hidden in their hideouts are collectibles, funds, and paint jobs, which, were Ubisoft a little braver, would have drawn you into reason too. You simulate a complex aspect of the world. You give players a reason to make interesting decisions regarding it, and you'll discover the gameplay that dynamic systems create is special. I've always simply said dynamic, but most often, you'll hear it being called emergent gameplay, finding the perfect place to ambush an enemy patrol with allies you found on the way, all to make a dent in Call of Chernobyl's dynamic faction war is the perfect example. Ubisoft don't go quite that far. Faction territory is unfortunately static. Instead, influencing conflict between them is incentivized by distraction. Lead the police into a hideout, give them a bigger fish to fry. Spark a fight between neighboring gangs, draw them away from the prize. Need any more convincing? Gang AI simulates fear, like fear. If an enemy feels overwhelmingly threatened, they'll run. If they can, to a nearby allied hideout to get reinforcements. It's a manual witness system. It blew my mind. Ubisoft have been discovering that player interaction with dynamic simulations alone considerably increases their world's immersive quality. But when you're allowed to use those simulations to meaningful effect in gameplay, you boost immersion and potential for mechanical fun dramatically. It's not a love affair that started with Legion. London is shaping up to be the climax, but they've been leading the charge in the AAA scene for years, starting in San Francisco. That deserves praise as much as it does a spotlight. I wouldn't dare accuse Watch Dogs 2 of failing to go the extra mile. A mile? We're on a victory lap. It's simply a lovely touch that there's seals and sailboats in the bay. Who would have docked points if the game didn't have a sailing mechanic? Well, now you can dock points in a more literal way. It's wonderful that the fake profile you set up in the introduction becomes your online persona. And in a similarly brilliant way, your phone doesn't come with pre-installed apps, so in downloading them, the store itself acts as a tutorial. We're talking about a game whose corporate complexes have their own merch stores. Buy a shirt, you'll want to remember these visits. Of all the things in San Francisco to gawk at, it's the company premises that blow me away the most. Noodle looks exactly as a tech conglomerate trying to look progressive and playful would. To say they thought of everything would be to undersell the meaning of everything. Does everything include a slide? Didn't think so. Invite is only another example, so is Galilei and Titus. Watch Dogs portrayed the wolves, two nails the sheep's clothing, and so well that I consider it the goat, the greatest goat of all time. If I had to point out a flaw in presentation, it'd be the bizarre lack of traffic. This isn't believable for any video game city, let alone San Francisco. Otherwise, it was at the top of its game 4 years ago, and it remains completely unchallenged today. But dynamism wasn't the only mechanical change Ubisoft made from Chicago to San Fran. Producer Dominic Guai is on the record for having cited realistic and accurate locations as essential to encourage players to explore the open world. To that end, Ubisoft's characteristic tower design was excised, opening up the entire map from the start. But frustrations with their conventions were known and accounted for even in Watch Dogs 1. Chicago CTOS towers were largely unnecessary. It was the mere five control centers that took precedence. Each blocked you out of the system in their respective district until you slipped past the gates, walked over the bodies, and hacked your way in. Guai's intention makes sense, and it works. Feeling above it all from the start encourages exploration, right along with the first objective that has you cross the entire bay. But I question the cost of the sacrifice. A sense of progression to a city is important, just like a sense of freedom. Hacking feels like less of a superpower when you have no base in the same game to compare it to. Equally, the city feels like less of a threat when you have no need to master it. And it should feel like a threat. This is San Francisco, but it is gripped by Bloom and hemorrhaging its corruption. The game will tell you this. It'll say it over and over until you start hearing it in your sleep. But will you ever feel it? There's never been a technological dystopia that wasn't allowed to take itself seriously, and for good reason. Or so I think. This is a quote from Pretentious Elizabeth, who wrote her thoughts on this game in last year's comment section. Watch Dogs 2 might be the better representation of the modern dystopia, specifically because of its tone. See, Watch Dogs 2 is cyberpunk, but based on the world around us. A company that controls half your life isn't some big, ominous corporation blackmailing people and having ties to the mob. It's a service with a smile, making you happy to be a part of it, even having relatable PR. The company with the single largest unmatched monopoly on Earth, owning half of all media produced, is Disney, whose privately owned parks are marketed as the happiest place in the world, and whose products and franchises do genuinely bring joy to millions, if not billions. Watch Dogs 2 reflects that. Bloom isn't the ominous megacorp of Deus Ex's cyberpunk of old. It's Google, fluffy and colorful and minimalist, reflecting today's megacorps to act as speculative fiction, as good cyberpunk should. She goes on to apply a similar point to DedSec, that perhaps portraying them the way they are is exactly what makes Watch Dogs 2 profound. By the end, we'll be able to decide whether or not we agree, but for the record, I entirely agree with her ideas on PR. San Fran's colorful nature is reflective of a controversial tone shift, but that's exactly what these companies do. As proven to me the other day, when YouTube sent me this. And fair warning, it's quite possibly the worst thing written by Homo sapiens since Pitbull's last song. Hi, Whitelight, while you're cozying in, sipping your whipped coffee. Yeah, okay, YouTube, I get my caffeine from gamersups, wearing your mask, which I of course drinked my whipped coffee straight through, and keeping a safe distance, you're probably looking for inspo and tips for your channel. YouTube, you're making me want to commit backwards vehicle hack. Noodle, of course, bears absolutely no resemblance to a similar colorful search engine that it may or may not rhyme with. And Deus Ex? Funny Elizabeth mentions it. Seems to me the developers and I have something very much in common. Human Revolution is, as I've made quite possibly too clear, my favorite game. It's surreal and surprising to say nothing outside of that series has ever felt any more like it. But is it a surprise? Both made by French Canadians, both feature horrendously outdated memes, both set in a technological dystopia, both boast freedom of choice in gameplay. Like, for example, in how to tackle the new and almost identical security camera. Their range is far shorter than Deus Ex, but they behave in the same way. Side-to-side rotation, destroying it will raise the alarm, but using the stun gun can temporarily blind it. Watch Dogs 2 distributes itself through dedicating each operation to a specific issue, and more often than not, it's a company. This tends to result in an infiltration that has you avoiding cameras, stunning guards, reading emails, and traveling through vents. In the name of freedom, Ubisoft drops these missions in packages. Deus Ex was never so liberal that way, but the structure remains remarkably similar. Company after company, a string of infiltrations and exposés. Similar souls, different bodies. And yet, despite all of this, I couldn't see a single shared name among the credits. There's no one out there who argues Watch Dogs 2's gameplay was anything but an improvement over the first. It warms my heart to know that meant becoming more like Deus Ex, and doubly so to know it nevertheless creates its own identity. Let's find out how. You can consider the typical level design that of a cover-based shooter, but with a particular focus on realism and vents strewn throughout alongside hackables. We've covered the tenets of FPS design many times previously, but it isn't the perspective that makes those rules work. Any shooter, including Watch Dogs 2, can make use of them to great effect. Clustered, varied cover, rarely too bad to be useless or too good to provide lasting comfort. Arenas tend to exist in rings, where an outside circle surrounds a central no man's land, creating flanking opportunities, interactions between different positions on the ring through the empty space, and within the ring itself. There's a risk-reward in trading between exposure and speed of navigation. There's a literally heightened level of verticality which creates those interactions on more than one plane, in this case often involving the use of larger hackable objects. These tenets are just as useful in Watch Dogs 2 as they are in Fear, because they aren't designed for a perspective, rather to get the best possible gameplay experience from fighting enemy AI. Stealth, combat doesn't much matter, as long as there's sightlines and most of your work is done from range. Watch Dogs ticks both boxes, but what about when there's not even any enemies? The smart home is protected entirely by security features. Even free from the classic formula, Ubisoft still knocks it out of the park. With no enemies, Watch Dogs is comfortable getting denser. Laser grids, robots, three layers, stairs, a way in from the roof, jumper access points, an elevator in from the basement, a way to use that elevator to hide, creating a new path by using a vehicle to smash glass. It's a dense but sprawling sandbox. And yet, despite all its intricacies, Watch Dogs 2, like no other game I have ever played, maintains a mind-boggling level of believability. Half the credit, no doubt, goes to the environmental artists, but for the other half, we need to have a closer look at these closed-circuit terminals. Real life isn't a video game, real buildings aren't made for players to engage with, but level designers want to put you up against a sequence of challenges all the same. There's a conflict. Here's the solution. If your objective is to reach a locked office, the closed-circuit terminal can be the key, and what that allows Ubisoft to do is place the office in a believable location, while having there be a substantial challenge to get in. Because what's a believable location for a terminal? Could be anywhere. Like, behind a challenge. It's one of the smartest ways Ubisoft indirectly use hacking to strengthen the gameplay experience. But no one ever bought Watch Dogs for indirect hacking. No, this was a franchise sold on coded spells read from an online grimoire, and that is why absolutely no one was disappointed in 2014 when all it amounted to was an iPad minigame and a QTE. For the sequel, to make absolutely even less people disappointed, Watch Dogs 2 aimed to improve in scale, utility, motivation, and accessibility. There is more to hack, there is more to do with each hackable, there are more pronounced reasons to pursue a hacking playstyle, and there are fewer barriers between you and the hacking. Where do we start? Marcus's most distinguishing feature is, of course, his penchant for robotics. Reasoning why Ubisoft went in this direction took far longer than it should have. The answer was too obvious. The jumper simply exists because it's a fresh and exciting way to play ghost stealth. The vast majority of objectives can be completed with remote control alone, and pathfinding a way to make that happen is an appreciable mix-up. When your restricted mobility forces you to find a more interesting path, and peripheral vision is weakened. The quadcopter, meanwhile, can't do any of those things, and yet you'll use it just as often. Because this isn't a playstyle. This is a moving camera, which in combination with NetHack tears down the first game's barriers between you and the hacking. Here's how. NetHack is detective mode. It has three key utilities. Combat awareness, thanks to the red color contrast against the gray background, a display of the location of access keys, and the ability to assume control of drones, lifts of any kind, and cameras without line of sight. This is what matters. It negates Watch Dogs 1's necessity for a chain of cameras. A blessing for the level designers, to be sure, and a blessing for you too. Though it may not be as atmospheric as prying into a CCTV network, too substantively broad a sandbox is probably best served by removing as many obstacles as possible between you and controlling it. NetHack is a welcome addition, and if it returns in Legion, I only hope it looks less rancid. Now the walls have been torn down, it's time to find out just what CTOS 2.0 can do. Starting small, the distraction. Text to guard some Azure Lane Rule 34 to cut off their vision cone. A perfect opportunity for a melee or stun. Time it well, you only have a scarce few seconds. Getting bigger, we've got remote-controlled scissor lifts, washers, and cranes, which often allows you to creatively and spectacularly form your own infiltration routes. We have multi-direction vehicle hacks, which work to a similar effect if you ram them into a fence from within. But the depth potential multiplies when you consider synergy. Vehicle hack works four ways. A little bit of forward with a right can make a corner a lone right couldn't. Best of all, a back combined with a forward doesn't reverse the direction, but instead acts as a brake, allowing you to choose how far it should go. Summoning vehicles that way can be an intricate and ridiculously stylish skill to master. That's exactly why it's so immensely satisfying to bring your ride to you. But you can get wilder. Grenades no longer exist, instead IEDs are sticky and limited by cooldown. It's a high-risk, high-reward strategy to strap a bomb to a vehicle and send it plowing into an encampment. Want unrestricted access to your arsenal and to make your escape at the same time? Vehicle hack will turn this game into just cause at the press of a button. Perhaps you're waiting above from a crane, sniper at the ready, connected to the hackables below through your remote-controlled quadcopter. Perhaps you're using it to remotely deliver a non-lethal explosion, or perhaps you'd rather let someone else do the work for you. With gang hit and police APB, you can falsely accuse any enemy of being a high-value target. The revenge or the arrest will ensue with distracting consequences. I seem to remember using that distraction to have guards on the inside of a building open the gate, allowing me to use my remote-controlled scissor lift to jam it open permanently. And don't think Chicago's precariously placed electrical junctions have become any less of a health and safety violation, where once you'd only time the explosion, now you can turn the device off entirely, set it to blow when an enemy approaches, and attract such an enemy to do so. Proximity hack is the first game's wasted time surgically removed. It's typically quickly combined with an attract. So instead of sitting on your ass waiting for a guard to stroll into place, you can set that up and move on. The broadened, balanced, and refined gameplay sandbox creates the skill ceiling, that colossal room for mastery. But what do we combine it with to ensure all those possibilities become depth? One word. Vulnerability. Marcus's vulnerability and Watch Dogs 2's more punishing security features are offset by systems you can master within encounters. Yes, he dies in seconds and is put up against lasers, cameras, robots, and miniature armies. But unlike Aiden, Marcus has access to this vastly expanded sandbox. It's exactly that vulnerability that pushes you to use it. Because if you don't, you'll regret it. And so we have a depth now that almost everyone is encouraged to experience. To quantify, this isn't just good for you, Ubisoft. It isn't just an unforeseeably massive improvement on the first game. It's fantastic for what it is. Vulnerability ensures depth, but deep gameplay is not Ubisoft's only goal. We're Marcus Holloway, we're not Aiden Pierce. How do Ubisoft encourage stealth over combat? How do they encourage the hacking approach within stealth? And how do they encourage non-lethal tactics? We'll start by having a look at access keys. I believe they're a ruse. Access keys are a designer's trick. Think about it. What do? They block off all your hacks in a certain area. Without them, you're playing limbless. You'll always want the key to the door of the sandbox. So how do you get them? Well, you net hack your way into the camera system, or more likely, you fly your quadcopter into line of sight. Was that substantial gameplay? Did you make an interesting choice? Was there a challenge to it? No. Access keys are always stuffed well within the level, and you'll always go to get them. What you're doing isn't a challenge, it's a reconnaissance flight. Did you notice? Probably, but I am convinced it was intentional. Ubisoft needed some kind of replacement for the first game's camera chains that made a thorough scout of the level likely. And it's no coincidence that only the quadcopter receives an X-ray enemy tagging upgrade that in combination with NetHack makes it practically telepathic. Chances are, you do a scouting run, but by strong-arming you into a good one, the designers get a chance to show you the level, enemy placement, and opportunities within it that if you didn't see, you might never have experienced, particularly given how easy it is to be detected without the utmost situational awareness. Though, that is true for the wrong reasons as much as for the right. In Watch Dogs 2, if you're detected by anyone, even for a split second, every Muppet in a 30-block radius swan dives into battle stations and knows exactly where you are. This is a gaming cardinal sin, taken to such an extreme in this case that, because of the nonsensical whims of this white gauge, I'm completely okay to knock someone out with a melee takedown, but not with a stun gun that induces instant paralysis. Here I am, watching a guy get mauled to death, but because I came out just a second before the dog got bored of tearing his throat out, he still had time to telepathically send his mates my exact coordinates. For a game that wants you to avoid lethal play, I'm struggling to see the wisdom. Instead, it's the player that's likely to take action. Restart from checkpoint. The right way of doing this was to leave things at a quick baseline detection rate, itself a rather rare feature for the open world genre. This is not Shadow of Mordor. This is not Assassin's Creed. If they can see you, they can see you. That directly disincentivizes the get in, stealth takedown everyone you see, get out gameplay so many other stealth games rely on. It aims to solidify Marcus as only a piece of the puzzle, to place a far greater impetus on Watch Dogs 2's more wilder options, the jumper most of all. The distraction similarly, but it isn't a wild option. It's accessible by the press of a button. This acts as a counterbalance, because what it is really is a stealth accelerant. In a literal sense, as a mechanical catalyst for fun, it cuts out downtime and allows small mistakes to fly under the radar. With less risk, you may experiment more aggressively. You may consider more of the sandbox, and that is very much the goal. This accelerationism starves combat of oxygen. If detection is less frequent, then combat is less frequent. But detection should still be a threat. No threat, no risk. No risk, no vulnerability. No vulnerability, no depth. And the relationship between distraction and detection is not perfect. Too little risk, and it's not aggressive experimentation you encourage. It's exactly what a quick detection rate aimed to prevent. Get in, stealth takedown everyone you see. Because what is there to stop you? Well, in the toughest encounters, which are universally the most important encounters, that'd be the overabundance of sightlines and enemies. But in a hideout with your late game abilities and confidence, mashing distract to a hollow victory is all too easy. Be it perfectly balanced or not, Marcus's part of the sandbox is defined by his two tools of the trade, the stun gun and melee. A more cowardly game would have let the stun be a permanent takedown, The wisdom to putting a 3-minute timer on it is balance. The stun is an instant body shot takedown from range on 90% of enemies. Were there no disadvantage to it, the choice of long and exposed melee against quick and safe stun would not be the interesting decision it is. It is that, and an encouragement. It's not uncommon to see games with a lethal-non-lethal dichotomy guilt you for killing, but then give non-lethal fewer and less versatile options, one of which is that mind-numbingly repetitive choke animation etched into every gamer's brain. Watch Dogs 2 has a smarter take on things. The stun gun's effectiveness makes it a fantastic strategy no matter what your proclivity towards patience or mercy may be, and that way you're naturally guided into non-lethal stealth, exactly as the game intends. Doubling down to this effect, defenders play a surprising role. Even with all their strength and armor, they will be taken down instantly with melee from the start of the game to the end. In a firefight though, good luck. This contrast in danger makes the defender a walking, talking stealth incentive. You can beat them otherwise, but it'll be far easier quietly. There's a reason you see them in the toughest stealth encounters. Where once you may have chosen to shoot everyone to bypass the challenge, now there is no such option. It is through these aspects that Ubisoft attempts to corral you into a playstyle that aligns with the tone and characters. This is a game of public image. Watch Dogs 2 experiences a nuclear case of ludonarrative dissonance if you ever go against that.
Cost us a lot of followers.
If you don't know what ludonarrative dissonance is, it's pretty much that. It's when your character during gameplay acts in discordance with the narrative context. Most games wouldn't need to worry about it, because most games wouldn't have such pronounced options that directly conflict with the tone. But here they are. They're options that, yeah, despite each and every significant change made to discourage them, you're likely to take more than once. Certainly in the few situations the game forces you into where stealth is so tough comparatively that open combat is unmistakably the best option. Watch Dogs 2 did a great many things, but if it truly wanted a consistent tone, it didn't do enough. And so, if the community debate is anything to go by, we have come to an impasse. If translating Watch Dogs' gameplay into a light-hearted tone was too tough or too great a risk, then should they have ever made this tone shift at all? All I'll say for now is that with no reconciliation to speak of, Watch Dogs 2's wavering identity becomes a curse engraved into its gameplay. As an easy example, the gang hits. Yeah, just because Marcus didn't pull the trigger doesn't mean he isn't responsible for murder. Killing is making a choice. No less true when he commands a 3-ton truck to ram someone at 40 miles per hour, or bludgeons meat and bones with a swirly-twirly sphere of reckoning. The removal of grenades in slow-mo prevent this game from ever matching the blood-pumping quality of Aiden Pierce's Punisher playstyle, but the deed had to be done. If you could chain headshots in bullet time, they might as well have included glory kills for all the good these stealth encouragements would do. But with the benefit of hindsight, they might as well have. Watch Dogs 1 had glory kills. They were simply for the sake of believable efficiency rather than gratuitous violence. John Wick's absence in the sequel is no doubt justified by similar reasoning, to keep the focus on stealth. But these purely visual takedowns could never encourage a combat playstyle without slow-mo to keep you safe. Tone and personality? That doesn't hold up either. If you're ever in a combat situation, Marcus is no less skilled in close quarters, and no less of a butcher. There's no focus to protect you here, so you'll butcher in a different way. Combat is defined by vulnerability, which practically translates into a simple understanding. Shoot them before they shoot you. This is what the designers intend. That's why they've got such generous enemy outlines. It's why you can disrupt comms at the press of a button. It's why NetHack makes you feel like the Dark Knight. You aim before your own eyes can see. With aggressive AI that fully intends to flank, swapping cover for sightlines, choke points, and distance make positioning a factor in combat of unprecedented importance. Yet with abilities that allow you to predict and disrupt enemy attack, you can be as aggressive as you must be defensive. You can push while you continuously consider what cover to take. John Wick's off the table. Hackers are on. Just not one with a clear conscience. A troubled soul, but a strong body. Early on, I considered melee to be its only mechanical flaw. Animations are long and uncancellable, likely to embolden the risk in that stealth risk reward. But with glass-like vulnerability in combat, being caught at the animator's mercy is invariably frustrating. I'll concede you can always see where enemies are, but you can't know what they'll do in a 5-second time window. A roll of the dice, enforced by Marcus's lack of self-preservation instinct, can create a distinctly unfair feeling. Combat is sacrificed for the stealth sandbox. Worthy, but unneeded. Yet another justification for retaining Aiden Pierce's takedowns would be an automatic switch to non-lethal, quick, or cancelable melee animations whenever a lethal weapon is equipped. There's no reason John Wick can't aim for the foot. And I didn't misspeak. Non-lethal takedowns with lethal weapons gives players an action-packed, high-octane but tonally cogent combat experience, albeit very difficult without focus. My frustration and disappointment were overshadowed by something far worse. It's a predictable poison: stagnation. The two-weapon limit, like most games with a two-weapon limit, introduces a considerable depth in the interesting choice of what to bring. Every archetype is useful, but you can only have two. However, due to the cost of each weapon, and the fact that you're likely, and clearly intended, to regard combat only as a last resort, making that decision is a rare occurrence, very much unlike most games with a two-weapon limit, which will inevitably leave the average player with the same loadout for vast portions of the game. Pick up someone else's? What, and have to go back to the 3D printer every time you want something decent again? Well, it's all to encourage stealth. But is it? Supposedly. In fact, it's what people often reference first when talking about how this game disincentivizes combat. But there's a reason I didn't reference it. Here's a mystery. In comparison to Watch Dogs 2, Aiden's arsenal only made combat more likely in subtle ways. Chances are you've got a sniper when you need it, that kind of thing. If you intended a stealth playstyle, you'd simply stick to the Spec Ops 1911. For a non-lethal tone, what would have made combat less likely is reducing ammo count for that arsenal. 10 bullets, not 500. But Watch Dogs 2 doesn't make this change. 2 guns or 38. Combat is just as sustainable as it was before. And what that means is, Watch Dogs 2's weapon limit tries and fails to encourage stealth by making combat less fun. Good job, guys. With no grenades, fewer weapons, and a stupid whirly disco ball, combat is left with only one avenue for evolution. Enemy variety. Yeah, about that. I know Control-C, Control-V is Ubisoft's favourite button combination, but I expected a little bit more than the same three archetypes as 2014. Punk, Punk with a stab jacket, and Punk with an everything jacket. I'm sure they can come up with something. Punk with more mobility, for example.
I'm fast as fuck, boy!
Punk with stealth attributes. Punk with a drone. Punk with a phone, for hacking. Punk with their own detective mode. The DLC's jammer is too little too late. Instead, the gameplay I describe comes to define every single combat encounter you'll ever have. A trade of comms hacks, positions, and bullets. If you choose to pursue it even rarely, it cannot uphold the game like the first could. It trembles towards the end. The people asked for an integration of hacking with combat, and the people received. But in doing so, Ubisoft ultimately made it a lesser experience for the sake of tone and personality. The question of whether gameplay should have been firmly cut down to fit, or tone should have never been so dissonantly upbeat, will have a different answer for everyone you ask. Mine? We'll come to see. But for combat, I do have a solution. Rubber bullets. Yep. Seems like an overly simple solution to such a complex problem, huh? Well, it is, except without the overly. They make combat no easier and stealth no less incentivized. If we can suspend our disbelief for non-lethally being ran over, and the 500 average IQ Death Stranding player never questioned it, we can slip this by two. Trust me, we can. Because we already have. The footage you're seeing isn't a mod. I had to go back and edit the script when I played the No Compromise DLC, and found out Ubisoft read my mind. 3 years ago. Before I had the idea, but I'm still taking credit. These aren't rubber bullets. Instead, you've got an air shotgun and a stun sniper rifle. That's smart. What they've done is give rubber bullets a personality. Were this expanded beyond two options and properly balanced in the base game instead of sold a year later in a DLC nobody bought, they might have cut the problem down to size. The best argument against this solution is, grim inevitability. If you fix the dissonance, you would no longer fear the dissonance. If you don't fear it, you would be less likely to avoid combat. You would be more likely to choose a playstyle with demonstrably less depth. I'd take that sacrifice. Self-restrictions are better than the ever-present threat of undermining the quality of the game, but that's the situation we're in. This is a game where you go from being a major player in what DeadSec clearly understand as the chess game of modern humanity, to Alien vs. Predator discussions on the ride to destroy yet another megacorp. This is a game where you spend half the first act goofing around with a techno car you robbed from a movie set, followed by a comedic police chase with Wrench pretending to be a racist AI, pop culture references to things that don't even exist, and an 80s construction montage that ends with green cybernitrous flying out of the exhaust. It's stylistic, concise, and not boring even for the slightest second. It's utterly ridiculous, and yet pure entertainment. This is a game that thinks it's hip, despite having a meme game so outdated even a fucking brontosaurus would have said you posted cringe. Look at this man. My cat's dragged in corpses who could have come up with something funnier than this. Something tells me Ubisoft aren't operating on the nth degree of irony. But these memes right here, these are definitely kek. Kek or cringe is yet another universal dichotomy to which this game proposes a compromise. Is it cringy? Often. Is it funny? Often. It is both kek and cringe, but to any extent, it is entertaining. Watch Dogs 2 has Assassin's Creed Syndicate's fun above all philosophy. Except, you know, this is set in the 21st century. It deals in utter flamboyance, and though it may infantilize the dialogue, the characters still come across as mostly human beings. They're written with a charisma to match their traits, and the dialogue reflects their external conflicts.
I have friends that would love to put DedSec behind bars.
Like a good fight?
Hey, so did you.
Excuse me?
Oh, I watched you go toe-to-toe with New Dawn back in the day. But hey, I get it. You a councilwoman now.
No. You don't get to pull that I sold out crap on me. These assholes wreck lives on a weekly basis. They went public with videos of my surgeries. But here's the thing. I don't give a shit. I got nothing to hide. You're right. I am a councilwoman now. My hands are tied.
That's why you asked me to meet you here. You need my help.
Looks like you need mine. Plus, I finish what I start.
Ubisoft goes so far to bring these characters to life, I sometimes wonder how they even did it.
Okay, now where's the GPS?
Hey, sit down.
I got me.
Come on.
All right. GPS. I know where the GPS is. Up. Got it. There you go. Okay.
This isn't a surprising incident. This kind of charming interaction is consistent throughout the entire game. It's world class, even for AAA production budgets. An easy explanation for why I enjoyed the entire cast. Which is weird, because somehow, they're quite possibly the shallowest characters Ubisoft have ever created. They are walking, talking personalities who walk and talk so well you'll forget you know nothing about them. Marcus Holloway? Who's that? I have no idea. His fears, the reasons for his aspirations, his internal conflicts, his backstory, his ulterior desires, family, all classified. I know he doesn't like Blom, he somehow has absolutely nothing to lose, and that he's real hip. Wrench wears the mask because he's shy, Sitara, nothing, and no, those three obscure audio logs aren't good enough. Josh, and Horatio? Well, I rate his hair. You get the picture. I enjoy watching DedSec, they're amazing fun, but a deep connection is next to impossible to form with a personality instead of a person. Fun, but not deep. Where have I heard that before? Though, given how fresh and entertaining Watch Dogs manages to so consistently be, it certainly surprised me how believably they managed to tell the stories throughout all of the first act. To find a way into New Dawn, Marcus pretends to be one of their auditors, on a visit to Jimmy Siska, otherwise known as Not Tom Cruise. He's been having doubts, so we play into his fear of repercussions. Creative and believable. Then Marcus drops this.
Oh yeah, man, and one last thing, man. Like, your last five movies have been just disappointing as shit, so act better. Alright, keep your chin up. Peace!
Entertaining. Then you bust Siska out of a re-education camp, infiltrate a $1 million temple, and take a central elevator down to a display of ancient relics. Theatrical, and yet believable nonetheless. Disguise using celebrity mouthpieces, recording video of the fakes. Marcus's plan is entirely rational, and the characters act exactly as you believe they would. After Marcus makes a move on Mary Catskill, the CEO of Invite, plot, character, and dialogue culminate in this.
Marcus, is this a bad time? Sort of feels like a bad time. And she drinks it with ice. I don't really need to introduce myself, do I?
I know who you are. That night at the beach, man, I knew you looked fucking familiar.
Well, Venus must have been in retrograde or some bullshit, because I think it was fate that I was in the night that you hacked into our system. I had to meet you, and there you were, pissing on your sneakers. All brains and no aim.
What's Bloom's CTO doing in the office of the CEO of Invite? And why'd you boost our numbers? This the part where you offer me a six-figure salary?
No, fuck no. No. You could coat circles around most of my programmers. No, see, I can't pitch. CTOS 2.0 is a state-of-the-art security system, and then hire someone that's on the no-fly list. Whoa. I just came here to have a drink. But hey, if you want to have a drink and a dance, I'm in.
Oh, you think it's a fucking joke? Huh?
Do it. Roll a fucking punch.
You got everybody eating out your fucking hands thinking the system's bulletproof? You can't see the people you're stepping on.
Guess what, Marcus? Guess what? The people want to be told who is good and who is bad. They don't care how it works, only that it does.
But it doesn't fucking work.
A few fucking civilian casualties is the cost you have to pay for the betterment of the world. You're fighting a war no one gives a shit about. Y'all are just swimming upstream right into the grizzly's mouth.
So why'd you prop up DedSec's numbers?
There's no one in Silicon Valley could throw a proper punch. That, and you're a great investment. You're so aggressive, so indignant. You frightened the rest of Silicon Valley right to my doorstep.
You used us to sell CTOS 2.0 to them.
It was the ultimate deterrent against hackers like you. And now, everyone needs my protection. So, here it is, Marcus. Your record is back on file. Your backdoor access is plugged. And those bots I gave you, they're gone. Oh, and there's a warrant out for your arrest. Hacking, corporate espionage, and breaking and entering.
First things first, he sounds exactly like Shammy. Second, I haven't seen characters so alive since Black Flag. Dushan's entrance is the perfect display of this game's strengths, and the first major consequence to all of DedSec's meddling since the game began. We can only run. With DedSec locked out of CTOS and their reputation dragged through the mud, Marcus brings the homies down to the Swelter Skelter Festival. I pity the fool who fails to explore this place. Do these sculptures remind you of anyone? Marcus came here to reunite DedSec, and the hacking challenge seems like the perfect place to do it.
I'm Ray.
It's Raymond Kenny who congratulates you. T-Bone's reintroduction is Watch Dogs 2 levels of theatrical, but not uncharacteristic. He's still the paranoid man he was. And he's still hanging out with Tobias, who you can find fighting a man with a giant plastic sword. If only one person ever gave a shit about bad blood, I'm glad it was one of the people who made this game. With T-Bone on board, his skills are enough to get DedSec back in play. Just like that, huh? Is that good enough? I think we'll soon find out. But now, we're back in the city. And I, for one, would like some fucking cash. The economy of Watch Dogs 2 is driven by clothes, cars, and weapons. I will admit, the auto market is slightly undermined by being given one of the best cars in the game, indefinitely, in the first mission. Bit of a misstep, that one. But it isn't the best, and the weapons are nicely balanced against the price. I need something robust, precise, capable, for a world of online grimoires. Ah, I know. You have a product, a service, a blog. You need a centralized network for your brand and identity. Don't go to Bloom. You're looking for Squarespace. Trust me, I've been to their YouTube channel. Dushan's been out now, stayed, and they weren't even trying. Robust. Precise. Capable. It's accessible, it's clean, it's what you might be looking for, and above all, it's an opportunity to kickstart your online presence. Try it. You don't have to enter your payment details until you're satisfied, and when you are, you'll get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain with my link below. We live in a society. Connect to it with Squarespace. So, let's get to work. Marcus Holloway is no fixer. He doesn't run criminal jobs for money. Get with the program, guys. In the 21st century, you gotta be an Uber driver. With emphasis on the driver. In honor of among the greatest racing games I've ever played, you pick up jobs through Driver San Francisco, a reference with shockingly deep roots. After the Driver franchise was shelved, Ubisoft Reflections went on to work on the first Watch Dogs game. In fact, this very engine was originally built for Driver. We are, by all means, playing that long-forgotten racing franchise's spiritual successor. Reflections worked their magic on this game too. And so it is no surprise that the app is more than just a reference. It's closer to a sequel. San Francisco's genius was its brilliant intertwining of fantastic gameplay with decent narrative. But they were so interwoven that both were taken to new heights. You can't transmit yourself into another person's body in Watch Dogs, but just like Driver, you can control their cars. I had to remind myself what game I was playing when I delivered a guy to his drop-off point, and it turned out to be a hit I had to escape. The hints were slowly dropped throughout the conversation leading up. Don't expect Watch Dogs 2's side content to hit the heights of a legendary title 5 years in the making, but it does the best it can with Watch Dogs mechanics. I got baked.
I just vaped some dank OG buds, so I can barely see you.
I did some jumps. I helped a guy escape a basketball scandal. Every instance has something going on, narratively or mechanically, often both. And that's why it's often brilliant. I can't tell you how happy it makes me to see Driver San Francisco honored this way, or to see Reflections continuing to make their mark. I am a known and registered Watch Dogs driving apologist. I still attribute the hatred to people exalting GTA as some kind of gold standard. But 2 made the logical choice to turn down the weight. Where in Chicago every power slide had you plowing civilians, but not in the fun way, cars are now snappier and drift far less broadly. Logical, though, perhaps isn't the best choice of words. To help you understand what Reflections have done for us here, it's probably worth pointing out that cars handle better going backwards than they do going forwards. Why? Well, in Watch Dogs 1, you J-turn like a pimp. In Watch Dogs 2, you J-turn like a chimp. A chimp could pull off these slides. I'd wager that's the reason, to create an easily accessible sense of action behind the wheel. I'd typically disapprove of dumbing down, but in practice, easier J-turns bring far more advanced strategies into the average player's purview. Whipping around to fire out the front, or a power slide into a J-turn to make the Fast and Furious choreographers jealous, which they fucking should be after this disaster. Need for speed, least wanted. Cerebral? Not quite. But it's appreciably fresh for open world games, and it's not so tough to suspend your disbelief for car physics. Unlike the Nitro Boost, which you somehow hack into existence, it's pretty dumb. But let's turn up the heat anyway. By which I mean, let's turn on the heat. Chases, the police. At a fundamental level, one of Watch Dogs 2's most interesting innovations is a cure for GTA's telepathic police force. You commit a crime, they somehow know exactly where you are, even if there are no witnesses and you've since moved locations. In Watch Dogs 2, heat is an investigation before it's a chase. What that means in practice is being able to get away with crime, so long as you aren't found at the scene. It's distinctly more immersive and more liberating, but perhaps that last one isn't such a great idea. Making it more forgiving than ever to act like a scumbag is yet another example of thermonuclear cognitive dissonance, and if that list gets any longer, I'm gonna need an external hard drive. Thankfully, we do have some degree of counterweight. Karens. That's right. If a witness completes their call, you're instantly detected. I guess they put you on Mum's Net, which as we know is an FBI honeypot. In comparison to the first game, calls are far longer and far easier to prevent with a simple hack distract. But because you're likely to be occupied with a fight and their newfound rarity makes it similarly likely you've taken off once the crime's done, there's a good chance they make the call. A chance that isn't high enough. But at any rate, this isn't just an improvement over the green circles of judgment directed by the will of God, it's possibly the smartest and most robust police detection system I've seen yet. On the road, an otherwise decision was for chase breakers like steam pipes and traffic lights to cost 2 for an automatic proximity hack, but only 1 if you hold on and time it yourself. You're asked to consider cost effectiveness, you're encouraged to use more skillful techniques. It's yet more depth squeezed out of the Watchdog sandbox, at least in comparison to the first game where it boiled down to a forgiving QTE. I once said that dynamic gameplay is a chain that's as strong as its weakest link. And in Watch Dogs, that quantified the effect of ridiculously exploitable strategies. We're talking about a game where you could escape a 5-star police chase by getting on a boat and sodding off. Or getting in a train and sodding off in real life. Because at that point, you can just put down your controller. The police cannot catch you. No need to worry about that in the sequel. There isn't a train, and the police are competent at sea. One giant leap forward. Which amounts to nothing, because Watch Dogs 2 has exploitable strategies of its own. It's called driving. Real fast. That's it, really. Where once hiding could be an effective strategy, in Watch Dogs 2, it's not worth the effort. Outpace them. Speed isn't an inherently flawed way to beat police systems. In fact, a display of your driving skill is probably one of the best. But it becomes a problem when it's too easy, because it overshadows what might be more interesting techniques. Crikey, it's the Californian Rozzers. I know, I'll just keep doing what I was already doing. We also have to consider that a police system is rarely one to test stealth. Watch Dogs 2's strength is its sandbox, but only a fraction of it is relevant when fighting the police. What police systems typically represent, and what makes them exciting, is easy access, high quality gameplay. They spread out tough combat and driving challenges all across the map, dynamically and whenever you want it, which is exactly why they're so fantastic for replayability. But Watch Dogs 2's combat could never hope to match Chicago. And the driving? That's not enough. Not alone. For every improvement, the sequel's police cancels it out with a regression. Well, you win some, you lose some. And the driving was certainly a win. I never once felt drawn to fast travel on my endless journeys from one objective to the next. And as you can quite easily see, I am a highly responsible citizen. Unlike everyone else here, like, oh my god, let's put you on Twitter. Yes, if I'm not getting cash or being shot at just because I slaughtered a few people, I'm getting followers, living the Alinity life. Appropriate that one of the side missions has you hack and terrify a Twitch streamer so she becomes more aware of cybersecurity. Huh. Weird way to simp, but okay. What Watch Dogs 2 lacks in digital trips, it also lacks in those QR code things. But what Watch Dogs 2 also lacks in those QR code things, it also lacks in mysteries. But it tries to make up for all of that with side operations. These privacy invasions represent around half. They are by all means QTEs. But remember the game we're playing. With fantastic acting, theatrics, and a full use of that 18+ content warning, they never fail to be entertaining. Pedestrians, swatters, Ubisoft takes balls to put yourself in a game with themes like this. Otherwise, side operations can range randomly from weirdly abrupt throwbacks to what could be mistaken for the main campaign. Aiden's appearance was more of a faithful cameo. It's simply a cutscene built up by a display of his characteristic brutality. Default, however, got a gang of Rodentia Academy groupies who sought to leak everyone's data so they'd wake up about how little privacy they really had. Yet the connection to Default himself went nowhere. We heard his music, we saw his symbology, but after two bog-standard objectives, the operation was done. What seemed to tease something meaningful instead meant nothing. Well hey, if that's the case, maybe it's a meta-commentary on the first game story as a whole. At the very top of this distribution would be something like 911. It's the largest side quest in the entire game, spanning four full levels and multiple cutscenes. One of Watch Dogs 1's ideas that rarely sees use in 2 is preparing an ambush for oncoming enemies. When you were stuck in a fixed location, that'd typically involve IEDs and not much more. But in 911, the sequel provides a full readout of every predicted enemy location, and a vastly expanded sandbox. The depth potential in both ambush and execution makes this among the best Watch Dogs 2 has to offer. Sad then, that its structure needlessly undermines it. A narrative, and one with continuous urgency at that, heavily encourages three interesting gameplay scenarios to be bundled together instead of dispersed throughout the game. And so what could have provided a periodic, refreshing change of setup, instead tires itself by being repeated back to back. This is the one advantage the first game's freely selectable, no strings attached side missions has over the sequel. Watch Dogs 1's leisure versus Watch Dogs 2's commitment. 911 is a flawed gem. That doesn't mean it's not a gem. Never gonna fail to make me smile when I get to infiltrate Alcatraz prison for the finale. Considering the Dushan reaction and the DedSec expose, it seems almost likely this might have been intended as a main operation. Side content is strong, but even doxing pedestrians won't change the fact that it's not special. Every game has side quests, but only Watch Dogs had digital trips. Only Watch Dogs had AR games, as terrible as they were. I don't think distancing themselves into uniformity is true to the game's theme, or the right way to go. It's around this time Watch Dogs 2 starts shifting gears into a final act. DedSec sees an opportunity to rig a Galilei rocket launch, have their hardware hitch a ride into space. It's about time the game and series starts getting abstract with hacking. There's only so many companies to expose, but sabotaging a rocket launch to get a DedSec backdoor into orbit? That's a fresh and interesting concept. However, in true Watch Dogs 2 form,
for everything we've done, we still don't know exactly what Dushan's up to.
You think we'll find dick pics?
Have you been listening in our convo, Sitar?
If we get a hold of a Dushan dick pic, we have the ultimate leverage.
Yeah. Especially if it's small or warty.
Guys.
And knowing him, his dick probably has its own fucking man bun on it.
Dude. Brilliant. Hear that? Appropriate we're going to space because that's the sound of the atmosphere being sucked right out. Is it funny? Yeah, but is it too much to ask that this game takes its own world seriously for more than 60 fucking seconds? We're trying to hack space.
all right, guys. That's enough. We've upset pops over here.
Listen, you fucks. Don't you okay boomer me. I'll have you know we hacked the world. Yep, we hacked the world. With Galileo's satellite, we have access to every Bloom data farm across the globe. And so, one by one, we compromise it all. The theatricality makes it entertaining alone, but it culminates in this monolithic hacking minigame. Braindead gameplay has never felt so cool. With Bloom's network compromised, DedSec seeks to expose the remaining companies. From here, it's only a matter of time before Silicon Valley is at our mercy. Invite is the first to go. Mark Thruss has been bought and paid for from the pockets of big tech. Mary Catskill and Dushan are rigging the election in his favor. Social media didn't work. We made sure of that. So now it's time for Plan B. Fraud. We have no choice but to destroy the machines entirely. And we're going to have a wonderful time doing it. But not for its level design. Brian Rietzel doesn't return for Watch Dogs 2, which sadly leaves us with a thoroughly dull soundtrack for all but the admittedly fantastic main menu. Musically, this game's boon is its radio. They license soundtracks from just about everyone. It's a far richer library than the first, a muscle Ubisoft flex in their opening mission. Despite my initial despair, I truly wish Watch Dogs 2 employed this more. It's hard to explain how important music can be to a scene, and that includes this game's sandboxes. Fort Point was among my favorite levels in the game, thanks entirely to Fortunate Son blaring in the background. The rest is left with a bland, inconspicuous mishmash of wubs and dubs. This is no Human Revolution. It's not even Watch Dogs. Which left me in quite a dilemma. I usually spend days scoring these videos alone. But, like the Sword of Gryffindor, in my moment of need, I was presented with salvation. BeatsByKlay contacted me, with the sci-fi trap hip-hop blends you've heard in this video on numerous occasions. They fit Watch Dogs 2 like a glove. They fit the video just as well, so you can find his links in the description. Ubisoft, you hiring? For everyone else though, the media player is a limited solution, and that's when it's even available. There's a reason cinemas don't ask you to bring your own MP3 player to screenings. Very few people will regularly use it, and none of them will know the best possible track for any given location or scenario. I found my experiments, well, let's just say Hard Bass carries its gameplay disadvantages. You don't want to miss Fort Point, but you just might. In trying to destroy the rigged booths, you're quite likely to realize just how easy it can be to abuse some of the unlockable skills. Late game, you'll be able to drop explosives out of your quadcopter, like a drone strike. And if you make that connection, this level is, by every meaningful measure, nullified. It's the first time you've ever had a destroy the thing objective, and the level design is open as can be. Mass Destruct similarly becomes a get out of jail free card, a 5-second window to do whatever you please on a ridiculously forgiving timer. You can run from hideout to hideout, mass distract, whip up the money, and be out before anyone knew you were there. Most vitally, you'll, with very little effort, gain the ability to turn off security features. Ah, I see you're having trouble with your levels, sir. Tell me, have you tried turning it off and on again? The press of a single button replaces encounters that would otherwise take situational awareness, challenging acts of timing or the risk of a perfectly aimed stun. The only thing being hacked now is the game itself. If a disruption hack was necessary, have it blink the power on and off, create a more forgiving timing window. That at least takes several motor neurons. This game needs an intervention, because its relationship with difficulty is looking more toxic by the minute. Unbalanced strategies can often be countered by the lethargy associated with them. You can gang hit every guard in a hideout, but even if it is a safe, uncounterable strategy, you're going to want to commit backwards vehicle hack by the end. Can the same be said for something at the tip of your finger? The temptation to simply wave away a problem in an instant? No. What might shift the balance, however, is difficulty settings. If we simply associate fun with decision-making, and we understand that depth is the sum of balanced choices, then Watch Dogs 2 is going to be at its most fun when you're considering as much of the sandbox as possible. For that to be the case, you need to be willing to experiment. To excuse taking risks, you need the ability to make small mistakes and recover from them. If a game is overwhelmingly difficult, you degenerate to the most reliable, exploitable strategy. and so the depth of many options is reduced to the safety of one option. In an unbalanced game, that option becomes far too clear, far too quickly. Degenerative strategies in Watch Dogs 2 are like demons on your shoulder if you crank that slider up too high. Though it can encourage extremely satisfying complex plays, the game doesn't have the balance to uphold its realistic difficulty. Invite down, Tidus to go. I know you want to go back to posting cringe watchdogs, but the intervention isn't over yet. This was the point in the game, not where the difficulty confused me, but where its curve did. Things had gotten progressively more challenging from the start to the FBI hideout, which itself was a difficulty spike so obscene I imagine I've triggered more than a few PTSD flashbacks. I welcomed it. And yet, 5 hours later, Galilei's conveniently placed cargo container makes this level practically skippable, while Invite, the penthouse, and Fort Point were smaller levels whose infiltrations featured fewer security systems and fewer guards. As I grew far too strong, the levels didn't change much at all. Invite is child's play compared to the hideout almost 10 hours later. It's puzzling, but I cannot leave it at that. This is no minor issue. The gameplay is noticeably undermined mid to late game. With only hours left on the clock, I wished for a new dawn in more ways than one. And Will Smith came through for me. Tidus is Watch Dogs 2's magnum opus. It couldn't have come at a better time. This corporation is a monster. A silent beast with military-grade security and a monolithic headquarters in the heart of Silicon Valley. Noodle lives in Tidus's shadow, both as a company and as an operation. Posing as a bus driver won't be enough this time. To match the power, this infiltration must be prepared for. Wrench Jr., rigged with an EMP, is guided into their robot repair warehouse, where he's shipped inside the premises and detonated. A believable Trojan horse. The art style is appropriate, mesmerizing, and beautiful. That makes no fucking sense. How can it be all of those things? The art style is as appropriate as it is gorgeous. The infiltration is set up with style and intelligence. It jacks the difficulty curve back into place. You're presented with a new obstacle along with all of the old ones, and it is, like Noodle, underpinned by a narrative. Wrench and T-Bone butt heads for this run. If you needed anything more, then follow Marcus into Tidus's depths, where Watch Dogs 2 repurposes the spider tank digital trip into a diegetic climax. Destroy Tidus from within, with their own weapons. It's utterly brilliant, combining wondrous and challenging level design with a strong sense of pace and a narrative throughline elevates Tidus and Noodle to the podium positions. But it's this fantastic use of exotic gameplay that gives Tidus the gold. It's the best Watch Dogs has ever been, and a blueprint I can only hope Legion chooses to follow. Well, we did it. Here we are, Bloom's doorstep, one left to go. But there's something missing, someone. Mid-game, you'll receive a disturbing message. All you have is a location and a concern when you find Horatio's phone lying at the scene of his kidnapping, just like Wrench. But the Tezcas are not the FBI. They cut open his belly, and he bleeds out in Marcus's arms. The performance is chilling. It's a refreshing change of pace to see Marcus motivated out of something that isn't idealism, the one time you can let the bullets rip guilt-free. These are the first people Marcus has to kill. Though you can melee them, seems unlikely he did all this just to give someone a nasty bruise. So that puts the minimum kill count at 4. And then... what? I'm not being dramatic, seriously, what? Back to the status quo? There are no psychological consequences to several counts of murder? I've drawn your attention to this before. Watch Dogs 2's writing is otherwise tighter than a fly's ass pulled over a jam jar. Not like that analogy, but where it unequivocally and catastrophically fails is consequences.
Then flood the fields with it and light it up.
Did they not tell the voice actor he's supposed to be sad? His best mate got filleted 30 seconds ago. I'll give due credit for killing one of the gang, but at the hands of the Tezcas, my hope for consequences and believability could never come to fruition. We've gone toe-to-toe with Bloom, wrecked Noodle, Home, New Dawn, and pissed off a holy hell lot more. We wrecked Home in more ways than one, but it's the Tezcas who kill Horatio. Right. This isn't the consequence of anything we've done. It's a completely random occurrence. The gang has developed little and suffered for only the briefest moments over the course of a war waged against Silicon Valley. An ongoing domestic terror campaign having no effect in the material or psychological worlds shoots this game's believability square in the head. Incidentally, this gives me reason to brand Marcus Holloway a Gary Stu. Aiden was no less capable than Marcus, but you can suspend your disbelief when you're playing a fully rigged ocean-going fucking nutcase. Aiden had an abstract, nearly delusional moral compass. He was deadly serious and bitterly motivated. It was the consequences of Lena's death that turned Aiden into a monster, and the consequences of his journey that convinced him he was righteous. But Marcus is one of us. He likes movies and pizza. I bet he's even subscribed to Whitelight. So when he renders a juggernaut unconscious in 5 seconds with a ball and a piece of string, cuts right through the full force of the law and the most powerful corporations on the planet. With mastery over hacking, combat, parkour, and driving, I'm struggling to buy that. Let me try to paint a picture for you to help understand the extent of what we're dealing with. Watch Dogs 1 had a DLC, Bad Blood, dedicated to T-Bone's reckoning with the death toll of his 2003 blackout. His grand gesture killed 13 innocent people, Default's brother among them, which would ignite the drama to follow. T-Bone had to learn to forgive himself, but Default could never let go. That's why it's slightly fucking insulting that in Watch Dogs 2 he aids and abets with blowing South Korea's entire power grid. YOLO! If you're slow, T-Bone actually comments on this. He says, "I hope that kind of thing doesn't bother you." What, was this supposed to be good enough? Yet again, with Watch Dogs 2's half measures, this isn't T-Bone. This is a bastardized impression of the character we once knew, who jokes around with his Mr. Poop cap while helping DedSec commit international terror.
"I'm gonna go for another beer."
Remember when Dushan locks you out of CTOS? Didn't matter, T-Bone cast a spell, and all DedSec's problems magically went away. The FBI are hunting you down? This has no meaningful effect. You're placed on Homeland Security's most wanted list. Yeah, actually, they deepfake you into BronyCon 2020 and leak the posts on Reddit. No, they don't. They don't do anything. A villain exists to create problems for the heroes. You don't need to have written Breaking Bad to understand that any decent story, from nursery rhymes to sagas, need consequences. But as things get heated, Watch Dogs 2 stubbornly refuses to allow Dushan a bite to go with his bark. Whatever whimsical deed he does to remind us he exists is counted in speedrun time. So how could I be afraid? And I should be afraid. I'm walking through the doors of God corporations, but Watch Dogs 2's absolute lack of consequence results in an absolute lack of stakes. Nothing can go wrong, it's the unwritten rule. And so, like in Bloom's headquarters, nothing lands with dramatic weight when inevitably everything goes right. We get it all the records, all the secrets. Time to break the news.
"What's good, homie?"
"Marcus? I have to say, I don't really see the win in you coming here, but... Oh, wait. This isn't some petty macho bullshit, is it?"
"Could you stop us if it was?"
"What, you and Encino Man here?" "I don't know, I'm liking my odds. Fucking Vegas is liking my odds."
"Yeah, Encino Man here..."
"I know who the fossil is. I've been elbow deep in Ray Kenny's head, massaging his code, improving it, overriding it, but I gotta give you some props, though. You had chops for someone that was clicking two rocks together. Kudos to you."
"Well, don't go getting all hard on my account, Dushan. This isn't exactly what you call a social visit. It's more of a, wouldn't you say?
Fuck 'em and leave 'em situation."
"Yeah, that." "Right.
Right, well, I'm always up for a fucking run, but... why the hell are you here?"
"Oh, man, it could be important. But let me tell you a story. Our story. Everything you've done, it's all out there now. Violating the public trust, manipulating the stock markets, the lies, the fraud.
Fucking bellwether. All of it.
Bluffing.
What happens if you actually answer it this time? Maybe it's Bloom sending you to face the firing squad alone. Or maybe it's your lawyer telling you there's no place to run. Maybe it's just a telemarketer. You really should answer it this time. Whoever it is, you're done fucking people over.
That cutscene was a microcosm of Watch Dogs 2's story. It is a display of its greatest strengths, those terrific performances, the fantastic dialogue, an unfailing entertainment value that never allows a dull moment. It's also a display of its greatest weakness. Consequences. That becomes clearer as time goes on, but it climaxes here. The ending supplants any visible repercussions for Blom with Dushan's arrest. And the reason for that is obvious. This franchise kinda needs Blom. Without CTOS, there's no hacking. Its core conceptual enemy is gone. It would be like Assassin's Creed without Templar's hidden blades and hoods. Oh shit. And so, the ending is left without meaningful consequence. Perfectly characteristic, and characteristically unbelievable. Even focusing on the single man, Dushan is arguably the most powerful person in the world. He's intelligent, that's been proven. And yet, he didn't predict DedSec would come. As every company is struck down, one by one, Dushan becomes impotent. He watches as each operation is exposed, never thinking to raise the guard, shut things down, find the hackerspace. And something tells me he'd have no compunction for threatening family or torture. All it took in the end to take down Silicon Valley's megacorps was a stun gun, a remote-controlled car, and some nerds. Sounds poetic, it even sounds funny, but this isn't a joke. This is the power we seek to fight. And they fought back, how? By desperately scampering around? Dushan becomes so impotent your brain starts rationalizing it as laziness, as if he can't actually be bothered to make a move. Perhaps this is the result of having 8 separate writers. Any one couldn't influence the overarching plot in a way that would affect the others. And so, like an episodic kids show, each story has to revert the characters back to the status quo. We also have to consider that by nature of a mission select screen, only the times when there is no choice can even be considered opportunities for substantial consequences. Because at the times you're given, say, 3 to choose from, the order you choose is uncertain, so you know nothing in any one of them will have lasting effect on the others. Or perhaps I'm just clutching at straws. Maybe the mission select screen never had to do anything because the damage was already done.
It is capable of pumping out an arsenal of lethal weapons down.
Seriously?
Yep. Once you master it, voila! Hipster merchant of death.
All good, except I'm no hipster.
You keep telling yourself that.
You can't stare into the abyss and expect it not to stare back. But an upbeat tone was mandated, and so a status quo had to be enforced. You can't take a white paintbrush to Yin Yang and expect the world you portray to be believable. Your logic is flawed. And so, like with the combat, like with the stealth, every measure taken was merely a paint stroke. Because nothing could ever be enough to realize this insane goal. To put 1,000 astronomical units between themselves and Aiden's Chicago. This iron focus convinces me of its responsibility, but it didn't have to be. Every good story is believable, but there are good light-hearted stories. How does that work? Disney, Zelda, Ori. Take the most unbelievable, light-hearted, goofy-ass worlds you can think of. And within them, you will always find believability of character. They have their sad moments, their consequences. Personalities may be atypical for our world, but they're not set in our world. Believable characters create a compelling story. And if it is the goal to do so, believable characters send a human message. Every good story has believability of character. But Watch Dogs 2 allowed its lightheartedness to infect and destroy it. If it didn't, it might have had a fantastic narrative, but nothing could have stopped the lightheartedness from killing its themes. Unlike Wind Waker, unlike The Lion King, Watch Dogs and Assassin's Creed similarly do not seek to send human messages. They seek to send societal messages. In this case, a message directly reflective of our world today, of a real place, of real companies, and their very real actions. Ubisoft's themes require believability of world, and of character relative to that world, our world, to land. That rules out assassin comedians. That means consequences. If you fail in this respect, and oh, did Watch Dogs 2 fail, you sever the connection, you starve the meaning. For Watch Dogs and Assassin's Creed, unbelievable levels of forced lightheartedness is a curse that turns ideological conflict into a weak, unimportant plot device, and dystopian philosophy into mere flavoring, despite a setting and premise based entirely upon it. If Watch Dogs 2 had to get away from Aiden so badly, it still could have had an amazing story, but it would always have to kill its themes, to smother its soul. Ubisoft are the FIFA 12 Emil Heskey of video games. They put all the work in, they line up the shot, it's an open fucking goal! And They've put a spectator in the emergency ward. Fool me twice, what was it, shame on me? Because we're two for two. Watch Dogs 1 decided to develop a technological dystopia without the conventions of cyberpunk. Where Deus Ex was about somewhat believable conspiracy predictions for the future, Watch Dogs is about somewhat believable predictions for today, and through CTOS, an image of what today could very easily be. It seemed poised to send a dystopian message, an Orwell-Huxley double punch, to put it in T-Bone's words, or a tasteful exposure that the only thing in today's age with more brake horsepower than a Bugatti Veyron is George Orwell's corpse, to put it in mine. But instead, it chose to be a mild, unambitious revenge story, so why go to the trouble of all this dystopian world-building? One had the tone, but not the focus. Two had the focus, but not the tone. Let me show you a casualty. One of the game's central conceptual enemies is the Bellwether. It does a pitiful job of explaining what it is. T-Bone only defines it as profiling, media manipulation, corporate collusion, consumerism, all driven by predictive algorithms, which fails to paint a particularly accurate picture, given the fact that even the Wikipedia page gets this wrong. My predictive algorithm tells me this lack of clarity did half the work. If society is a ship, and monstrously powerful data collection allows Bloom to understand its every intricacy, then Bellwether is an autopilot program. In practical terms, that's a prediction algorithm with an instruction manual. You want a specific future? Bellwether can tell you how to get it. It dynamically creates a mind control instruction recipe through means of manipulating lyrics in famous songs, fabricating internet memes, and otherwise influencing the media. Algorithm that advanced? I'd guess the main bottleneck is data. You need to know the cause and effect of every minor input on a societal level. So a company like Bloom might in fact be a prerequisite. But the point isn't that it does exist, it's that it could. It might. Like CTOS, its parts already do. Social media companies swaying elections? Illegal data collection? Celebrity mouthpieces? The difference between this and Blade Runner is distinct. A certain country has a system worse than CTOS, in effect, on our planet today. But androids are still the dreams of writers and bold scientists. That's what makes it special. That's what poises it to be uniquely terrifying. Were you scared? Its effort goes to waste, its soul is asphyxiated, leaving its omnipresent themes conveyable only in rhetoric, for better or for worse, and over. But why should you listen? This isn't set on our planet. It needed to be. There's a word for that. Propaganda. That's what this game is, and that's not its sin, but it's part of it. Viewed in this light, Watch Dogs 2's delusional black and white moral dichotomy is no surprise. Though Dushan originally had a semblance of philosophical justification for his actions.
Guess what, Marcus? Guess what? The people want to be told who is good and who is bad. They don't care how it works. Only that it does.
But it doesn't fucking work.
A few fucking civilian casualties is the cost you have to pay for the betterment of the world.
This is buried and replaced by lust for power, money, and control.
Titus and Bloom plan to put CTOS functionality into armed robots and use them against civilians. How does that sound?
Yeah, all too familiar.
DedSec, on the other hand, is never questioned or critiqued. They consider their actions for a matter of seconds before setting their sights on any number of people or corporations. With great power comes great responsibility, and this band of clowns couldn't define that word with a gun to their heads. But with the tone, we don't need to think about it. This way, we can comfortably black out South Korea. We can swatter to take some kind of moral high ground. And the guy who harassed Horatio, yeah, we ruin his life for doing his job. Keep in mind, 4 is the minimum kill count. That's not representative of the average player. If Watch Dogs 2 wasn't the way it is, DedSec's evil would stick out like a candle in darkness. But it is this way, and there is no hidden message to it. Not when this failure is only a symptom of its terminal disease. Plot, theme, combat, the very ludonarrative cohesion. 4 victims, 1 blow. Madness, inspired by desperation to escape the fox, split this game's heart. That's Watch Dogs 2's greatest sin. That leaves us with only one question. What's next for Watch Dogs? That's a question that could mean many things. What's next for the game after the campaign ends? What's next for any game alike? Multiplayer. Watch Dogs 2's most obvious change is the seamless connection between multiple friendly players, going about their way in their own game worlds. The effect is distinctly more sensual than mechanical. Seeing some Muppet drive his Ford Fiesta into the harbor contributes little to the gameplay, but much to the life of San Francisco. Witnessing their police chases and chaos is frequent, in direct contrast to Chicago, where enemy players were only presented quietly, in the shadows, like fixers, like hackers. It gave the online a certain intimidating atmosphere to it, but it was appropriate. When I think hacker, I don't think Florida man, but that's what I see. Ubisoft's abandonment of Chicago's eyes in the shadows allows them to integrate a far wider variety of online events than Invasion. DedSec Hunt is a simple favorite. You're hired to help the police take down their target, by any means available to you. The server lag makes it look like I didn't hit that, but I did. Which of course would mean... No, it was pure skill. I accounted for the bullet drop, the curvature of the earth, and the other guy's ping. All me, baby. On the receiving end, even outplaying your pursuers multiple times won't win you the event. On the attacking end, your success is usually determined by the speed of your starting vehicle, but it's the seamless nature that prevents it from being frustrating. With no loading screen, what do you have to lose? Getting screwed costs nothing. Armored transport costs time. This is a more involved, seamless event type. There's a truck, and a number of players want the cargo held within. First phase, hack it. That requires getting close. Second phase, stop the truck, get the package. Third phase, keep the package long enough to decrypt it. And fourth, escape the 5-star police level you most likely have, while also not being killed by other players. It is one hell of a task. But the fun is, of course, in the tension of trading between competitors. Or at least, it should be. The first time I found the armored truck, I did it. I kicked everyone's ass, I nicked the package, and bolted. Well, I don't know if that's an accurate word in Clifford the Big Red Piece of Shit, but I couldn't stay mad for long because, all of a sudden, the event ended. Odd, it wanted me to collect the package again, which would of course be in the back of this truck. But there it was, still on my back. I had to collect the package from myself. A command so contradictory, even the game couldn't believe it, leaving me irreparably glitched and unable to progress. Then the host migrated. Then, the next time I found the event, the truck was clipped into a building. Is this what they meant by seamless? And for the third time, as the saying goes, I won! I actually did it this time, because the online wasn't working, and no one spawned to challenge me. My point being, Watch Dogs 2's multiplayer is technically hopeless. They still haven't found a reason to keep invasion victims from simply leaving the session in the menu, making the seamless portion of the game endearing only through its chaotic social appeal. It's dumb fun at best. If you can find a reason to, the more consistent half of the experience is the co-op missions. Imagine a standard Watch Dogs 2 encounter, then make it slightly tougher, and integrate the simplest possible reason to have multiple players, either two simultaneous locations encouraging split-ups, or a closed-circuit terminal within an arena, once again encouraging splitting up. Those are the co-op missions. Sounds fun, right? It is! You don't have to bother with anyone else's bullshit on the higher end because you'll never find anyone else to play with, and on the low end, the novelty of Watch Dogs cooperation easily sells a couple hours of fun with an eager partner. There is nothing remarkable here. There is Watch Dogs 2's gameplay, and a social appeal whose inconsistency you'll hardly be frustrated by because its very heart is dumb, meaningless chaos. It sacrifices the unique soul of Chicago to do it. Whether or not that was worth it depends on you. An atmosphere of quiet fixes for a broader, more frequently involving range of activities? $15 for 3 missions. Those are the questions you're going to have to ask yourself when you want to know what's next for Watch Dogs. Oh, there's more to this game. We'll just have to visit the store page to find it.
I just can't do it. I can't take this shit no more, man.
What in the fuck is this? Is this Ubisoft's grocery list? How can there be an Ultimate Pack, a Supreme Pack, a Mega Pack, and a Season Pass? The Ubisoft Pack... The Ubisoft Pack is $5 to dress up like a Ubisoft employee. I don't remember signing up for any fucking San Francisco hippie-ass ayahuasca binges. I'm not hallucinating. What, does it harass you in the workplace too? I remember a time when a T-Bone content pack meant being able to play as T-Bone with an entirely new campaign. But I'm just about the only person who does, so who's there to complain about it? Season pass it is. I have never appreciated my patrons more. It's going to a good cause, okay? Not this, the Honey Select DLC, this is just work. Human Conditions is the main attraction here. It isn't an expansion, because it isn't an expansion. DLC would be more appropriate, but it's not what you'd expect from that either. Three entirely separate disconnected operations, packed into one paid drop. Why you couldn't pick and choose, I honestly don't know. But $15 is quite the price to live up to. Where do we start? RenSense, for anyone with the base game, might have looked remarkably sus every time they passed it. Big company headquarters in the game where every big company needs their headquarters broken into. When's your turn? Turns out, that'd be the DLC, where you discover, through the best character of all time, that they've been shooting up the homeless with experimental nanotech. It's an atmospheric location to explore. They even got Solid Snake after Kojima here, and the infiltration afterwards is just as cool. Enemy placement is perfect, with both a sniper and a jammer keeping the pressure on in different ways. Level design is a pillar of similar quality, with a dock in the center creating choke points, and an interesting way to move quickly if you ever need the speed. So, we gonna get what we came for? Well, after Lenny proves once again she is indeed the best character of all time, we find out. This ain't Tidus, nor is it Noodle, but it's close. RenSense is a beauty, and adorned with all Bloom's favorite toys. Uniquely, it has Lenny act as Marcus's counterpart. In the hacking puzzle, in the infiltration itself as she blacks out the system and blocks you from entering certain doors, but most interestingly, in the philosophical way too. Marcus argues for destroying the tech. It's being tested unethically, and that's killing innocents. Lenny sees the long term. Destroying the research could prevent a breakthrough, and if that sets a cure for cancer back 20 years, there'll be a fuck sight more dead than the people who died to get it early. It's interesting. Doesn't land with much weight, because nothing can. But I was engaged. Even Josh gets a chance to kick some ass. They're off to a damn good start. Automata follows the same formula. It's Noodle this time. You're being asked by Ubisoft to infiltrate their video sharing services and delete a channel called Blightlight. Hang on a minute. No, in reality, it's a self-driving car. You're going up against a series of three fantastic levels to get your paws on it. I never even considered infiltrating WKZ, but I'm sure glad we did. Automata ends on something of a set piece. It's a police escape. But in a self-driving car, you've got to do two things. Vehicle hack like your life depends on it, which of course it does, and then pray. Pray to God that Ubisoft's completely inconsistent AI won't simply try to ram you through a hail of bullets. It's more luck than I'm comfortable with. Marcus has the bullet holes to prove it. As sweet as a moving hacking minigame may be, you're rolling the dice to get there. I suppose rolling the dice on your life is exactly the moral problem at the heart of self-driving vehicles. Who does it choose? You or a pedestrian? How does it choose? That's the question Automata asks as unsubtly as ever, and answers it only insofar as it can make dumb jokes. I like it. Automata has embraced Watch Dogs 2's unbelievability, and taken it to such an extreme that Wrench abandons Marcus in a life or death situation so he can make a comedy skit in the newsroom. It's funny as hell. The themes are dead and buried. We're being thoroughly entertained by the dance routine on their grave. Bad medicine makes three, and there's no weak link in Human Conditions. Two wonderful arenas, an overhauled Brutva boat, and a dam are tied together by the return of the not pizza guy himself, Geordie Chin. He was the Watch Dogs 2 of Watch Dogs 1, and so in Watch Dogs 2, he has to become a full-on caricature to stand out. None of his classic wit is as compelling here because for one, it's just not written as well, and two, his contrast with Aiden no longer exists. Jokey guy against jokey guy? Geordie isn't the same. To recover a contrast, the writers play up his more psychotic tendencies. Marcus that way is often amazed at how unpredictably violent he is. He's a charming companion. I especially appreciated being left for dead in the middle of a kid's playground. You're looking at three solid operations of additional Watch Dogs 2. For $15? That's for you to decide. A sale might make that decision for you. How about another one then? $10 for one operation. Watch Dogs 2 had a second content drop. No Compromise, that valued its lone outing at double the price of any one from Human Conditions. Keep that in mind. The Moscow Connection is about an X-rated DedSec parody, and this is Watch Dogs 2, so when I say that, you know that I'm telling the truth. This game has absolutely zero hesitation to get some tits out. Not a complaint, but Citara doesn't want DedSec screwing their brand in more ways than one. After the swelter-skelter, we know what's about to come, and we know what's about to happen. BDS Mania has you camera-hack your way through, shall we say, explicit studio, with a giant alien robot to humiliate the director. You're literally given a sideshow of softcore. I'm gonna have to go full classically Abby on you guys, because in a different way to the Smash community, I don't believe in age restriction. Let's skip the P word, right to when you find Mr. Alejandro Jackowski. Marcus has him bend over so he can do things with, I don't know what this is, a degenerate table tennis bat. It gives a whole new meaning to backdoor access. Turns out, the Bratva don't like people nicking their premium accounts, so in a rare moment of weakness, Marcus gets kidnapped, and wakes up about 10 seconds away from becoming a dude smoothie. Shockingly, that's not where the game ends, so when you escape, Wrench helps you serve up some revenge. I wish he hadn't. The following levels are standard, unremarkable gang infiltrations. They are distinguished from a particularly nasty hideout only by the jammer enemy type. But you had to pay for this. The finale may be satisfying, but unless it's my Patreon, no explicit content is worth £10. Avoid it at all prices and at all costs. It turns out, what's next for Watch Dogs is simply more Watch Dogs. Sounds self-explanatory, but today's DLC is rarely so innocuous. You don't often pay another $15 and expect simply more side quests. You expect a new location, a new arc. You expect real significance. And if you want that now, you're not looking for additional content. What's next for Watch Dogs has become a much more literal question. When this video goes live, I'm gonna take a nap, and then I'm gonna wake up and find out. I have a disheartening impression that Watch Dogs Legion will join the hundreds of other tech dystopias with cyberpunk stylization and near-future Black Mirror themes, abandoning what makes Watch Dogs stand out. It isn't about the future, everything else is about the future. It's about today. I predict that Neo London will be too far out there to feel grounded in reality, and yet not far enough into the future to entertain solely through appearances. I predict that the conflict between Albion and the Resistance will be far more theatrical than believable, given that we've seen nanotechnology dynamically rendering corpses invisible, and yet somehow a totalitarian regime proves incapable of wiping down graffiti. I also predict it'll be a fantastic game. I hope I'm wrong, in only the right ways. And if that's the case, it'll be just like its predecessor. Flaws, yes, but wonderful in so, so many ways. With Assassin's Creed Origins releasing only a year later, it was about here that I began to question how much hate Ubisoft received, as if their 2014 disaster should define them. What defines them now is so much more complex, and so much more depressing. Truth is, Ubisoft has the same yin-yang imbalance as Watch Dogs 2. But where the game tried to cover it up, the company was exposed. We've known their dark side for years, that insatiable greed. But now we know, it's not even a safe environment for all our employees. Turns out, Assassin's Creed is the only thing Ashraf Ismail has been faithful to. If all the claims are true, it gets so much worse than that. With FIFA, EA successfully solved capitalism. They've won. They don't need to pretend to be good. And Activision is hardly different. There's no soul in the series of expressionless concrete walls they call a building. It's a brutalist enclosure for a cold, mechanical black hole of dollar signs. Ubisoft teeter-totters on the event horizon. They still push some boundaries. They still make competent products. Their soul is dim, but present and palpable. Because they're not EA. They just try so hard to be. Assassin's Creed 4 was directed by a man who has a black belt in infidelity, and yet, it is nonetheless one of the games that proved Ubisoft as a team still had an ember. Its defining quote was this: "In a world without gold, we might have been heroes." Ubisoft once more stand before a grueling ordeal. They found redemption last time. They can choose the right path again. Ubisoft are not damned yet. Not yet. Thank you for watching. I'll see you in London. While the credits roll, I believe some major thanks are in order. If you remember back to the intro of this video, that, my friends, was the return of Mr. Chimera in a suit. Same guy behind the prototype intro from last year. His generosity is outmatched only by his talent. And since then, he's become an editor full-time. That means he's taking commissions, if you like what you see. His links are in the description. Alright, we're doing it live this time, boys. One take, come on. Special thanks go out to Benjamin Carter, Bishop Nelson, Chase Ray, Ethaniel Haskins, Fabian Flack, Gurneil Kang, Hutch Puppy, I Know Lucky, John Lemley, Caleb Doss, L. Hudson, Lex Williams, Linus Newman, Mardi, Mr. T with some tea, Newts, Warthol, Austin Novosel, Corbin Davies, Effectfully, Abby, Alsis Wild, Andre Baltuta, Ballistic Rainbow, Binyamin, Bosian Tutu, almost. Brandon Harris, Brendan McDonald, Cameron Bowen, Chance Tucker, Christopher Richardson, Combat Wombat, Dan Walker, Devontae Williams, Dominic Jaworski, Drop ZZ, Dubs. What? Dubstep Gutterfan 92, that's a cool name. Ezio Lee, Flip Slip Me Dick, Hamish, Hey I'm Tim, Holy Shift, Jason Vickery, Joshua W. Schreiner, Juris Purins, Justin, Keshav Rangan, Leon Cuttendahl, Lyubomir Mitkov, Matophobia, Second Page, Nathan, Nines, Noah B. Satterley, Norm Ambroise, I'm trying my best with that one. Psy, Quarter Gamer, Rackin Hawk, Shade, The Last Great Opium Den, Tide Pods, Uriara Heap, Yeet Lord, Attila, Hypocrite, That's for the Birds. Yeah, and that's it. That's for the Birds. Thank you all very much for your support.